Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for being here this late on a Saturday afternoon. So my name is Stefano Zacchiroli. I'm a computer science professor at Paris Diderot University by trade. And by passion, I've been a free software and open source software activist for the past 15 years, as you can guess from my outfit, mostly in Debian, and this day also in the Free Software Foundation and the Open Source Initiative. But today I'm here with a different hat. I'm here with my Software Heritage hat on, a project of which I'm a co-founder and current CTO, and also the main topic of my talk here today. But before getting into that, let me show you a couple of code snippets. Does anyone recognize what this code might be? It's assembly, indeed. It's a big mess. So this code actually put human beings on the moon. So it's code developed by Margaret Hamilton and her team at NASA, I think in 1969. And it was the code responsible for driving the Apollo 11, but the Apollo 11 landing on the moon was guided by this code. And this is an example of how, as developers, we actually do amazing things. And we can make amazing things happen. And this is definitely in the kind of things that everyone would consider really amazing. And there are different kind of code which can do things that maybe some people will consider nefarious. And there is another test. An idea what this might be. And here goes the microphone. That's a bit easier. So this is a piece of code from the Morris worm, which in 1988, in memory serves, put the internet, as it was at the time, to these heels. And it contains pretty interesting stuff of the first widely available buffer overflow of the time. So the technique of buffer overflows was already known at the time, but this is the first massive use of the technique. And it's actually pretty neat if you are an hardware geek and you're interested in how VACs were running a BHD system at the time. You will find pretty interesting things about how the operating system works and how Morris exploited the finger daemon at the time to actually make his worm spread over the internet. So what do these two pieces of code have in common? Well, not much, not in purpose, not in programming languages, not in style, but they're both source code, and as such, they contain much more information than the actual bits that were run either on the Apollo 11 or on many computers around the internet. So in source code, you find structure, you find comments, and in general, you find knowledge. So what I'm getting at is that source code is not just a way to create software that it's executed on machines or on the cloud these days, okay? It's actually much more than that, and is all-time new in the history of knowledge generated by humans. So in source code, you find both executable information that can be run on a machine to make things happen, and you find the knowledge, well, hopefully, a lot of the knowledge that was in the head of the developer who actually wrote that code. And these two aspects actually really, really peculiar and specific to software. They didn't exist before. You have something similar in music. In a score, you have something like that. But in source code, comparison with a score, you have much more information which is specifically targeted at human beings and not at machines. So it's executable and readable knowledge. It's something also that evolves over time, so different from a book or from a song or from a play, is something that is not meant to be published only once. Source code is usually published once and then modified, and every time you make a commit in your favorite version control system and push it to GitHub, for instance, you are publishing a new version of this piece of code. And it's also an incredible maze of things, so a line of code that you have written yourself can call into other lines of code written by others, and vice versa, your lines of code, even if you do not know that, will be called by other people on other projects that are available in some software around the world. And this is an amazing kind of things to observe, to study, and actually to use. So, in fact, what we are doing as developers, even if we do not realize that, we are producing something, and you're producing a commons, what we would call in Italian a bene comune. Okay? So a commons, or a bene comune in Italian, is actually a kind of resources which is available for everyone at little or no cost, and usually we relate that to natural resources, okay, like water or air or land. While we have a specific commons that we as developers create every day, which is the software commons. So the software commons is defined as the set of software, which is available for a very little cost and can be freely modified and used for any purpose by anyone who actually wants to do that. So of course, free and open source software is part, is a big part, the biggest part of these commons. But also the code that today is not free and open source software, maybe because the source code is available, but the license is not free, or maybe because it's proprietary software written by some company that is, has not released it yet, it might become in the future a part of the commons. So if your company decides to publish old code, like for instance Microsoft did with very old version of DOS, well, that code becomes part of the commons. And even the code you're writing today, maybe for some proprietary product, might in the future become part of this commons. And this is not just an ideal thing. The software commons is actually useful also for very legitimate business reasons. It's a pool of code that everyone can use and reuse for their purposes. Okay, and create new amazing products. So it's interesting both at an ideal level and a very practical level for business needs. But where is, so if you want to have a look at this big piece of software commons, where do you go to find it? Well, here things start getting a bit complicated because it's very much scattered around. So of course today we have GitHub, which is possibly the largest code hosting platform that humanity has ever built. Okay, and a lot of code is available there. I'll show you some numbers of how many projects are available on GitHub. But still, you have a lot of code which is available on other platforms. SourceForge is still running. You have archives of some code which were coming from GitOrius or Google Code. So all this kind of stuff is distributed around the net. But the point is that you don't have a single place where you can go and find if a given line of code is available in the software commons. Okay, so that's totally fine, and maybe even GitHub, which is with us today, will not be with us, I don't know, one century or 50 years from now, but still, to appreciate the extent of the software commons, you have many different places you need to go to look for something. And also, this software commons is kind of fragile. So this is the mire of essentially any kind of digital information. So it's much easier to delete by mistake or by willful act a line of, some file on an hard disk than it is to actually burn down a library, as it happened with the Library of Alexandria. So it's much easier, for whatever reason you might think, to destroy digital information than to destroy physical information. Well, or information that is stored in physical artifacts. And unfortunately, this is not just theoretical. We have seen a lot of examples of these risks posed to source code over the past decade or so. So there have been attacks that have destroyed entire thousands of different software projects. It is the case of CodeSpaces, which is a commercial source code hosting platform, which has been hacked, and they hacked by some sort of ransom practice in which they said, okay, we have taken control of your cloud dashboard. If you don't pay something, we start deleting your volume one. And then they didn't pay, and they started deleting volume two, and so on and so forth. And didn't they have backup? Sure, they did have backup, but in the same cloud platform. So the attacker even destroyed the backup, and all the projects that were hosted on that platform actually disappeared. And of course, the company went bust. But there are other examples, less malicious. So there might be entirely legitimate business reasons to shut down platform that host code. I was a very happy user of GitOrius, because it was like GitHub, but it was an entire free software platform. But then GitOrius has been bought by a company that is developing a different product, and they just shut down both the product, the development of the product, and the hosting website. And Google Code, similar, okay? Google went into the business of hosting development, and then they decided it was not for them to do that job, for whatever reason they might have. And they are in the process of shutting down Google Code. I believe already now you cannot retrieve, you can no longer do a Git checkout or a Git clone or a VN checkout. You only have tarballs that you can download at this point. And there is other software that is available in physical media, maybe in some basement of some organization, that are going bad. Okay, and we're losing information stored there. So we all have used, I guess, the Internet Archive and the Wayback Machine. If a website disappears, you know you will find it on the Internet Archive. But where do you go if a given repository on GitHub, or for what it's worth, if the entire GitHub disappears? My answer for you today is that you will go to Software Heritage. Okay? This is a project that we launched in last June. And the mission of the project, put it simply, is to collect, preserve, and share with anyone who wants to access it the entirety of the source code which is publicly available on the internet. So if there is a line of source code that is out there, we want to retrieve it, we want to preserve it, and we want to share it with everyone who actually needs it. This is the mission. So I will give you more details about how we're doing this and the kind of things you can do with that. But first, let me present some general principles of the project. So we are adopting a kind of Unix philosophy here. We're trying to do only one thing, which is a big thing, archiving all the source code which is out there. But that's the only thing we're trying to do. We're not trying to do other stuff, like archiving other digital media which are related to software. And I'll talk a bit more about that in a second. And our idea is that on top of this thing, we can actually serve multiple use cases. Okay? So we can serve, of course, the need of cultural heritage preservation. UNESCO recognizes the need of salvaging digital information, and source code is a big part of that. There are plenty of industrial applications. For instance, there are companies out there doing tracking of where you have found some specific open source product on the net and tracking where you have deployed it so that when there is a vulnerability discovering that product, well, you know that you need to fix a given number of devices. Of course, there are research applications. So our idea is that if you add this in a single logical place, you can build the equivalent of CERN that physicists use for software studies. If you have all the source code ever written and ever published, to be more precise, in a single place, well, you can do software research, study bug patterns or vulnerability patterns, and there is an amazing field of study that can be supported by this kind of stuff. And of course, there is education. I'm a teacher in my main profession, so having a sort of source book where I can go and look for every single potential implementation of a given algorithm over decades would be really amazing for my students to have. So, but still, we are not targeting all those things. We're not trying to build all the possible application of the project. We are just trying to do the preservation part, okay? So, and the principle we are following to actually implement this are a principle that we set for ourselves in order to maximize the chances of succeeding, because this is a very challenging mission. So we're applying an open approach, which is some kind of responsibility, given we think the mission is very important. We want to be responsible in the way we approach that. So everything we are writing ourselves to develop this project is going to be free and open source software. If you are licensing geeks, all the software we write ourselves is copyleft, either GPL or AGPL for the web stuff. And it's already publicly available, and I will give you the pointer to the forge in a second. And we're trying to be transparent. So we're trying to run this as a free and open source software project in which we have a development mailing list, IRC channels, a public forge, and all the development happened there. And we are trying to build something that will be there in the long run. So this is not something that will be successful if it's around only for 10 years or 20 years. To be successful, this needs to be around for centuries. Okay? And the techniques we're applying to maximize our chances of that long life of the project is, of course, replication, because we cannot possibly imagine having a single logical place with all this information. Of course, it needs to be built to be replicated widely and geographically around the planet. And we're building this as a non-profit initiative. So not because companies are evil or anything such, but the interest of companies change when those companies are bought by other companies simply because they made different business decisions, like those who resulted in the shutdown of Gitorians and Google Code. So we're trying to build this as an international nonprofit organization, which has as a mission that of preserving all public available source code. So what are we actually collecting and saving in the archive? So the idea is that of putting the developer in the same condition they will be with the sort of Git log or equivalent. I'm not saying Git for choosing a specific version control system, but the point is that we do not only want to save individual files or version of files, but also their development history and the relationship between different version of files. So in practice, what we are doing is that we're going after version control system repository that exists out there, and source code releases that might happen outside version control system, like tarballs or zip containing source code. And of those archiving targets, we are extracting all file contents. So all file contents mean that if you find a SVN repository or a Git repository, you are not just saving the most recent version of the files. We are actually going down the history, crawling all the history of the version control system, and extracting all different versions of any file we find in there, and actually saving that. We're also saving all version control system related information. So this means commits and all the metadata of commits. It is author, timestamp, comment, and any custom metadata that might exist for a given commit, we are saving them with the goal of being able to recreate the very same commit which match bit by bit the original commit. Same thing for releases. Okay? So releases are usually just specific commits that have been tagged that this is an important commit that corresponds to a given release of the software, version 1.0, for instance, and we are saving this information, again, with all their metadata. We are saving project metadata, so for instance, the home page of the project, and pointers to other metadata we might find about the project itself. And we are timestamping all of this. So this is what is called by scientists doing preservation provenance theory. And every time we retrieve something new and add it to the archive, we annotate the fact that we have found it in a given, place. Usually it is the URL of the file of the or of the version control system, and the timestamp when that has that has happened. Okay, so when you find something in our archive, we can tell you all the different occurrences we have seen of this content out there on the internet. And we are doing this not simply storing a Git clone or SVN checkout or a tarball, but we are massaging this in a canonical data model, which is able to represent changes in all the VCS and kind of archive files we find, and uniforming everything in this data model. So this means that essentially, even if you have called something as subversion, you will be able to download it as Git or vice versa. I'm not saying all of this is implemented yet, but the design actually has that as a goal in mind. So what we do not archive instead? So we do not archive basically everything that is not source code or strictly source code related. For instance, we're not archiving home pages or websites of projects or wikis of projects. We're not archiving development mailing lists. We're not archiving backtracking system issues or code reviews. That we consider it's not our job. We're trying to do only one thing. Does that mean that this stuff is not important? Of course not. It's very important. Okay? But our vision there is that we will just play our part, that of preserving source code, in an upcoming sort of semantic semantic Wikipedia, in which you will join the dots. And if we have something that has been archived by the Internet Archive that corresponds to some source code, in that place, we will join the dots. And we are already actually implementing this in practice. We have a collaboration ongoing with the Internet Archive. And the idea of that is that when they find some home page and they discover there is some pointer to source code in there, they will call our API to actually make sure the code is collected and preserved. And vice versa, when we find a project that has some pointer to an home page, we call the API of the Internet Archive, in which we ask them, please save this page, because it's the home page of the project at the time we are archiving its source code. And the same thing might happen for other development-related information. So the architecture is pretty simple. So it's a standard crawler or search engine approach with a two-tier architecture. So here on the left, you have all the data sources. These are just some examples. Some of them we have already implemented. Some of them we haven't. So you have all the web forages. You have free software distributions. You have package repositories for specific programming languages, for instance. And what we do is that we have various listers that goes and visit these places and make just a list of the available projects or packages, depending on the kind of hosting site that is. Okay, this is a lister. The only job is producing a list of projects currently available. And that might happen either in full. For instance, we can say, OK, we want to release everything, or incrementally. We want to list the new projects or new packages since the last time we have been there. And the result of this operation is a set of points, abstract points, which we call software origins, which are related to specific URL where you will find either the VCS or the package, the last version of the package. And the idea is that here, by visiting multiple times those software origins, you will find new data, potentially find new data that was not available the last time you visited. And for depending on the type of these software origins, we have different loaders. Okay? The loaders are in charge of go visiting a VCS or a distribution, retrieve the last version of everything that is available there, and inject to our software archive only stuff that we have never seen before. So the loading part is actually as a built-in deduplication aspect. So we have seen this file elsewhere. No matter where it was, we do not store it. Okay? If we have seen it, if it's new, we store it. So there are many copies out there of the empty file, or many copies out there of the BSD license, or the MIT license. We store that file only once, okay? And the other time, we just keep a pointer to the fact that that's the file we have seen. So the actual archive is implemented as a Merkle DAG and an object storage. So just to check, who is familiar in the room with what is a Merkle tree? Okay, a few people. Not that many people, so I'll just give a very brief explanation. A Merkle tree is a data structure that is really popular. You're using it every day in Git, even without knowing. Okay? And it's a tree of hashes. So you have your data as leaves in this data structure, and you compute checksums, for instance, SHA-1 checksums of the leaves, and that SHA-1 is the ID of the node. And when you go up the idea of a node like this is an hash computed on the hash of its children. Okay? So the very cool thing about this data structure is that if you have two trees, very big, like the graph that is behind the linux.git version control system, okay? You just look at the top hash, and the top hash of the two trees is the same, you know that everything in that tree is the same. You don't need to look for anything else. You know you have all of it. Well, if the hash of one of the two is different, you just need to go down in the trees, and when you find a pointer to the other node, well, you know that that subtree is actually something you have already seen, which is already in the other tree. So it's a very efficient data structure, which is used daily in Git, in Bitcoin, in any distributed ledger system. It's using IPFS, if you happen to know about that distributed file system. And it's what we're using as a model for building our archive. So our archive is essentially a giant, I'll give you some numbers about how big it is. Merkle DAG is not a tree, because you have a clone, so you have multiple branches pointing into the tree. And this giant Merkle DAG with all the objects we have seen. So here, we have our blobs, which are essentially individual versions of individual files, just the content. So if you change a line in a file, for us, that's a completely new file with a different hash. Okay? And here, you have directories, similar to file system structure in any Unix system. Okay? So you have the root directory, which points to some subdirectory with a given name, okay? And go down to other directory, and at some point, you arrive at a specific blob. And that blob might also appear in a completely different directory or in a completely different project, but if the same directory with identical content appears in another project, well, you know it's exactly the same, and we store it only once. Okay? And commits are just this part here, or revisions. We use the term revisions, but they are actually just commits. So a commit, starting commit is something that has a label, that has a message, that has an author, and just happen to point to a directory. And a new commit after that, it will point to a new directory and to the previous commit, creating the output you see when you do git log or when you do git k. Okay? That structure is a commit structure. Revisions are just special kind of commits that have a label, say, I'm not a random commit, I'm actually a release. And finally, we have these kind of snapshots. So every time we visit a VCS, we take a picture of all the top-level branches in that version control system, and we compute the ID of that object, the snapshot object. And of course, it might happen that different version control systems out there have exactly the same content. For instance, if you do a clone on GitHub or a fork, at the beginning, the two repositories have exactly the same content. And even this snapshot object, we will store only once. This also means, as a side effect of this, that even if you rebase your content in Git or you do any kind of destructive update on your version control system, we never throw away anything. Okay? We will keep the snapshot of the previous time. Okay? Even if you have deleted it from your repository, it will still be available here, provided that we visited the version control system in between your previous change and the rebase or whatever other destructive update you did. So this is implemented as a in-house object storage for this. It's very simple. It's a Python 3 layer, which essentially just shard the different blobs based on the starting digit. And everything else, which is essentially a graph, is stored in a Postgres database. Okay, why a Postgres database and not one NoSQL DB? Well, the individual object we store are actually pretty simple. They fit really well in a relational database. And we needed it to scale to significant volume. So we have been going with Postgres. We've been very happy with that. And in case there are some crypto geeks in the audience, I said SHA-1, and one might say, is SHA-1 safe, given, you know, it's starting to show some weakness, and there are attacks that are pretty powerful on SHA-1. So it's still considered safe for data integrity purposes, which is our purpose, very different from crypto purposes. But still, given the attacks are getting easier, it will happen at some point that someone will push a SHA-1 collision to a Git repository. When that happens, Git itself will have much worse problem than we have here, but still we are prepared. So what we're doing is that for every single blob we store, we compute three different hashes and length. So we compute SHA-1, we compute SHA-256, and we compute a SHA-1 Git style, which is a salted version of SHA-1, and we compute the length. And we have unique keys on every single column. So we will see If we try to enter a content that has the same SHA-1 value but a different SHA-256 value, we will see basically primary key violation, and we will notice that. The joke was that we should have ready a crypto paper that is published automatically as soon as that happened, but we never actually implemented that. And of course, when that happened and started happening in the wild, we can use a different key, and for instance, an object ID that we have here that is not related to the SHA-1 at all. So we are ready for that as well. And we are in the process of adding SHA-3. We're just waiting for a decent implementation to arrive in the version of Python 3 we're using, but it's trivial to add. So what do this is not just theory. So we have a prototype of all this, which works today, and it's a pretty significant prototype. So in our archive today, we already have a full mirror, which is constantly kept up to date with respect to GitHub. There is some lag, okay, but we do have a full mirror of all, of course, public repository on GitHub. And we have injected as two experiments, all Debian history in between 2005 and 2015. So if you're familiar with the Debian infrastructure, we took all the upload to recorded in onto snapshot.debian.org and injected them in the archive. And we also injected all the releases of all GNU projects and, at the time of August last year. Plus, we have also retrieved, but not yet injected in our archive, a full copy of Gitorius and of Google Code, thanks to collaboration with the archive team and Google itself, and we are in the process of adding them to our archive itself. But at least, even if you are not in the archive, we have retrieved the copies, so it's, you know, an additional copy of that stuff that is so, that is salvaged somewhere. So these are numbers, some numbers, of how it's been growing over time. So we have right now, these are numbers from yesterday, I think, more than 3 billion files, which means 3 billion unique files, because we deduplicate everything. So the individual content of files, we have 3 billion different versions. We have indexed something like 700 million commits. And we are obtaining all this from about a little bit less than 50 million projects. Of course, it's completely dominated by the number of projects from GitHub, okay, but it will increase when you start tracking other sources. It's interesting here, you see a small notch. This is where initially we only tracked the repository on GitHub that were not declared as forks. And this is where we started tracking all the repository tracked as declared as forks. But you see that there is no equivalent notch in the number of source files, the number of commits. And that's actually the effect of deduplication. Because in forked repository on GitHub, sure, there are some new commits, but not that many, and not something you will see in a billion vertical acts. On disk, this is something like 150 terabytes of compressed blobs. So we compress individual files separately from others. So it's something like 150. Maybe now it's 200 terabytes. And a 5 terabyte database for essentially the graph structures and all the metadata associated to commits, tags, and so on and so forth. We have reason to believe that this is already the largest source code archive that exists out there. So what you can do with that? So the main feature we have rolled out in production as of now is basic lookup that something is in there. So if you have code of yours and you are curious to see if we have archived it yet, well, you can go on the homepage of our website, you can drag and drop the file or just enter it SHA-1, and we will tell you whether the file is present in the archive or not. We haven't rolled out yet download, but we're working on it. And the idea is that you will be able to do both wget of the tarball corresponding to a given commit and retrieving the equivalent of a git bundle of any commit we have stored. So it's a git bundle, it's just an export format. Okay, we can have other different formats, but that's given git is the most popular VCS today, that's what we are targeting first. And next in our roadmap, we have provenance information, so being able to tell you for every single artifact we have stored in our archive, where it comes from, and when we have seen it there, so you can imagine the... For every single file, we'll tell you the different places where we've seen. And you can imagine also a calendar-like interface, like the Wayback Machine, where you go and some repository disappeared. They will tell you, well, we have visited this repository N times. And for every single time, you will be able to download the tarball or the state of the repository at that point. And of course, then sky is the limit, really. So I would be a fool if I wouldn't say that I would love to have full text search on this. And we're testing with different techniques, so it's kind of pretty hard because you cannot parse this stuff because you have 10 different versions of C and 10 different versions of any language. So you can probably do some either plain full text search or some stemming based, like Google Code Search was doing. And you know, this is challenging at this scale. And my dream here is the ultimate code completer. So imagine integration with your IDE. You start writing something, and you look up into software editor and say, hey, it looks like you are writing this algorithm. I already have 10 versions of this algorithm in my archive. And this is under BSD, this is under GPL, and this is under MIT. Do you like to use one of them? Sure, you click, and you have the implementation of the function we're trying to do. Okay? From there to Skynet, you know, distance is not that big. So this project has been, so we co-founded, we're a small team, and the project has been funded by INRIA, with a French national research institution doing computer science with a strong free and open source software culture. And they have an history in founding things that then continued there on their path. For instance, they are one of the three founding partners of W3C together with MIT and KU. They are basically doing the incubation part of the project, guaranteeing funding for the first few years. And as it is a non-profit model, we're looking for partners. And we have some early partners. We have Nokia. We have Dunst, and we have Microsoft as some of the early partners. And we have plenty of declaration of support from basically all the famous organizations out there coming from either computer science or from free and open source software or from culture, with a signature with the UNESCO about the importance of preserving source code upcoming. And we are going global. So INRIA does not want to remain, you know, the steward of the project forever. So we're super glad what they're doing. But the real goal here is becoming an independent organization, which is an international organization, run as a nonprofit in a transparent manner. So this is it. So you could work with us if you're interested. So there are several ways you can do that. So it's run as a free software project. So you can go to our Forge, which is a fabricator instance, and you will find all our code. You will find pointers to where is our development mailing list, our IRC mailing list. Even if the project is in France, all development happens in English, which is quite remarkable. So the code is there. You're welcome to, you know, submit patches and get in touch with us on IRC or on the mailing list or whatever. We have a wiki where you will find the internship proposal if you're a student, and there are paid internship, which are not that common in Italy, but they are, you know, the law in France. So if you're as a student interested in an internship, you can have a look, and if you find some lead, just contact the person responsible for the internship. And we have a website where you will find both sponsorship lead, if your company might be interested in sponsoring the initiative, or we have a job opening right now. It's Paris-based. I see that most of the offers here are based in Milan, so if you fancy working in Paris, there might be a job offer for you. And really, so for anything else, feel free to contact me either now as a question and offline later. Thank you. Questions? Yes. I can go back to the.
Are you on AWS or Google Cloud or?
So we wanted to build something before approaching potential partners for mirroring. So right now we have two copies of all of this on the INRIA data center. So we bought infrastructure ourselves to do that. They are in two buildings, separate building, but not that distance. So it's like 500 meters. So not super safe. But so Microsoft, as one of the early partners, they are sponsoring us in kind, and they are offering to have a full mirror of this on Azure. So the copy, so it will be the third copy of everything, will be soon on the Azure cloud. It's not there yet.
Prime.
Yes, correct. So, but there are indeed interesting property here. So given it is a database to which you basically never change or delete anything, it's basically up and only. So that gives you very interesting properties in terms of eventual consistency, and it's easy to actually say, I have asynchronous mirror around the world. Okay? So that's what we plan to do. So right now we have two copies which are synchronously up to date one way or another. Azure is basically becoming the third, which will be asynchronous. But our idea is that any cloud partner out there or any hosting partner out there can be a part of this and host either the DB or just the object storage. Because already in the object storage, you have all very important information, which is the content of the files. Did that answer your question, or?
Yeah, more or less.
Go ahead if you want to.
I mean, I've seen 5 terabytes of data in your PostgreSQL. So you are probably shard your data over multiple instances, right?
Not yet, but we can do that. It's very easy to shard this data. Right now is a single, well, two instances, but it's actually scale up.
It's just
yes.
one
Correct.
Massive.
And it's actually doing pretty well. Right now it's in-house, but it's a very thin thing. So why it is in-house? So the point is that we do not want to impose technology on anyone who wants to be a mirror of the objects. So the idea is that in-house we can switch to Ceph or you name it. So, and we're actually planning to actually look at that. But we don't want to say to anyone, if you want to mirror, you have to use Ceph or you have to use anything else. So the idea is that the addition to any layer of this DB will be representing a sort of feed. Okay, we're using Kafka to actually have a feed of things. And you will have subscribers that subscribe to the feed and say, okay, you have something. I want to retrieve new objects since the last time. And you can store them in-house in whatever format you want. Anything else? Yep.
What is the latency of this system?
So actually, the performance there are completely dominated by the fact that 99% of the repository on GitHub see no activity at all. So what we are doing is that when I simplified here, so when you do the loading and the listing there, well, the listing you need to basically always do because there are always new repositories showing up on GitHub or any forge. But at this level, we are doing standard exponential bake-off. So when we stop seeing new stuff at a given repository, we double the period after passing on time. And you look at the graph. I should have put the graph on that. And you see that really it's like 2% or 3% of repositories that have some activity. So the rest is really peanuts in comparison to what you gain by optimizing there. Yep. So the starting value for this is, I think, either 32 days or 16 days. And then we go up until 64 or go down until twice a day. So of course, so again, here I'm simplifying. Here we're basically doing a pull here. We can also do push, clearly. So we have been in discussion with the GitHub folks that actually love what we are doing. So they are aware, and it's not like they consider us parasite or anything. So we discussed having a push API. But for them, it was just simple to say, you know what, just create more accounts and actually use the standard API, because it's much simpler for us than developing a push feed. But we are actually working with other forges. For instance, we're in touch with the upstream of FusionForge to actually add some better API integration in there. And both push and pull are options, of course. Honestly, I don't think it's very important to be up to date every single commit you do. So, yep.
Did you calculate some metrics about software creation habits of repositories?
Okay, so not yet. We are actually starting to use some of the resources we have on Azure to actually index in various ways a subset of all we have archived. And we are indexing now the repository with which have at least 1,000 star on GitHub, just to pick an interesting subset. And we are starting to index them in various ways, but we haven't yet actually tried to, for instance, do parsing of those things. And for what you have in mind, you do need to have those kind of things. On the other hand, modeling the ratio of creation of projects on GitHub, that's actually fairly easy. So we haven't done that because I think there are already various studies on that, but we haven't done that ourselves. Providing a platform on which scientists interested in that kind of thing can do that.
So an API?
Yeah, so my ideal model for that, the vision we have, is that you have this somewhere in a mutualized infrastructure, and we have, for instance, a private cloud, which is associated to that, used to do experiments. And scientists interested in doing the research just pay for the resources of the calculation, and this is a mutualized infrastructure. It's really the same model of the CERN, even though it's a very different science, a very different object of study. We have 1 minute left, so one quick question. I thank you all for your attention.